Good morning, everyone. I hope you had a great conference so far. I'll be talking about how you can write your own algorithms and data structures that follow the standard library philosophy, and why you should do that. Let's start with a quick question. Does anyone have any experience with writing their own data structures and algorithms that follow the standard library patterns? I see 1.5 hands, not so much. Okay, so let's get started. First, a little bit about myself. I'm a software architect from Belgium. I'm working for Nikon Metrology. I'm a Microsoft Visual C++ MVP and author of Professional C++, second, third, and fourth editions, and C++ Standard Library Quick Reference. So both books you can find in the conference bookstore, so feel free to pass by. I'm also the founder of the Belgian C++ Users Group, and for that I try to organize 3 to 4 events every year. And I think for a users group, these are quite successful. For a small country like Belgium, we get around 50 to 100 attendees for each event. I also have a quick announcement. So a couple of days ago, we launched a competition in Belgium for which I'm on the jury. And it's a contest designed to inspire creative and enthusiastic C++ students and professionals. So if you are from Belgium, have a look at it. There are some cool prizes to win, with the first prize being a mini drone. All right, what are we going to look at today? So first I'll start, in the first part of the presentation, I'll go deeper into writing your own algorithms. And in the second part, I'll be talking about containers. And as an example, we will develop a directed graph container. So there are quite a lot of slides, and I'm building up that algorithm. Why is it moving all the time? I'm building up that algorithm and container from scratch over a lot of slides. So I would like to ask you to wait with asking your questions until the end of the presentation, because it might be that your question will be answered on a further slide already. So in the lower right corner, if you can see it, there are slide numbers, so you can always reference a slide at the end of the presentation. All right, so let's start with the algorithms. Let's suppose you have the following requirement. We're going to need an algorithm that returns all the iterators to elements that in a given range that match a certain predicate. So it's kind of a find-like algorithm. There are a couple of options. So you could use the standard available find or find-if algorithm. But these return just one iterator and doesn't return you all the matches. Of course, you can use these algorithms in a loop, but let's not go there. We are trying to write an algorithm, right? Another one is copy-if. You could use that, but the problem with this one is it fills the output range with copies of the found elements, and that's also not what we want. Another option to avoid the copies is we can use copy-if in combination with a back insert iterator into a vector of reference wrappers. That sounds complicated, and it's also not entirely what we want, because I want to be able to know the position in the source range where a match was found. So we'll have to write something ourselves. Let's call it find all. Here is a possible initial version. So I'm just going to write my algorithm, not yet keeping the standard library patterns into account. So it's called find all. Let's accept a vector of values that we will search in. Let's accept a predicate, can be anything. It's just something that accepts an element from my container and returns true or false. And the return type is a vector of iterators into my vector of values. Implementation is straightforward, so we just create our empty vector of matches. We iterate over all the elements in the source range that we get, and for each element we call our predicate. If it returns true, we just put it in our results vector, and at the end we return our matches. So it's easy, but how can we use this now? Here is an example. So we define a container. It has to be a vector of values because that's how I wrote my algorithm. So we construct my container with values, and then we call my algorithm. We give it the values, and then we give it a predicate. In this case, it's a lambda, which will return true for every value that is equal to 5. And the results are stored in matches. And I'm using auto here, but it is a vector of iterators into my container. Once we have our matches, then we can query information about it. We can ask how many matches there were in the source range. And we can, as the last for loop shows, we are iterating over all the matches. And we are printing the position of each match that we found. So it's easy to use, but there are a couple of problems, especially, of course, in this line. So the first problem is it always returns a std vector. So what if I want my matches somewhere else? I cannot do that with this algorithm. And it always requires a vector of values. So it's templated on the element type. So at least I can have a vector of ints, a vector of strings, and so on. But it has to be a vector. So what if I want to search a list? It's not possible. So to fix this, let's rewrite the algorithm and let's follow the standard library philosophy, which use, so that's the next question. So what do we have to change to make it follow the standard library patterns? Anyone? It's still early. Okay, so we have to use iterators. We don't want to use a specific container like a vector of values or a vector of iterators. We need to use only input iterators and output iterators. So let's rewrite our find all algorithm. The first thing we do, we change the template parameters and we accept an input iterator. And as almost all standard library algorithms, we accept the range to search for as a range of input iterators. So that's the first and the last. By the way, in the bottom right, you see the old signature that we had. A second function template parameter, we have an output iterator, and that's where we will write our matches to. The third parameter to our algorithm is the destination to which we have to write our results. And as you can see, it also returns an output iterator, and that also follows certain standard library algorithms like copyif. And what it exactly returns is it returns an iterator to one past the last element that was written to the output. And of course, we still need our predicate. So now we have an algorithm, function template that accepts three template parameters. Implementation is also very easy. In fact, it's even shorter than the previous one. We just loop over all the elements in our input range from first to last. We call the predicate for each value. If it's a match, we write that iterator to the output. That is the line saying star output equals first. We increment our output iterator, and that's it. And no, it's not it. We have to return our output. So output at the end is pointing to one past the last element that we wrote to the output. Of course, like all the standard library algorithms that use output iterators, you have to be careful that your output is either big enough to accept all your matches, or you have to use something like an insert iterator. How to use it? The only change we have to make is how we call it. So you have to give it a begin and an end iterator to the range that you want to search for. I will be storing the results in a vector of iterators called matches. I'll use a back inserter, so I don't have to pre-size my container of results, and the rest is the same as before. The big change now is that I can use it on different kinds of containers. So here is an example. It's almost the same as the previous slide, but my values are stored in a list instead of a vector. And as you can see on the second line, I'm also storing the results in a list of iterators instead of a vector of iterators. Of course, a small change in this use is that I have to use distance in the last for loop, because list iterators you cannot subtract. So I need to use distance to calculate the position of the matches. And here is another example that uses two different kinds of containers. The source, the container that I want to search in, is a multimap in this case, and I'm storing the results in a vector of multimap iterators. So it's clear it's quite beneficial to follow standard library patterns. Users are used to it, so the learning curve is very small, and it provides you with a lot of flexibility because your algorithm is not dependent on any kind of specific container. All right, now that we have our algorithm, I just want to quickly say a word about iterator threads that sometimes come in handy if you're working with iterators. So what is it? It's something that provides you with additional information about the iterators that your algorithm is receiving. So it's a class template available in the standard library with a couple of type aliases. You have a value type that you can use to query the type of elements to which your iterator is pointing to. And you have a couple of others. One of them is the iterator category. That one specifies if you are handling a bidirectional iterator, an input iterator, a random access iterator, and so on. So here is a simple example. I have to include the iterator header. That's why where the iterator threads are defined. And I have a function that accepts an iterator, and now I can use iterator threads to query information from that one. Here, it's a complicated way to define a variable called temp that has the same type as the type to which my given iterator points to. So it's the value type. Of course, in this case, I could just use auto temp equals star it, but that doesn't help in explaining iterator threads, so this is the more complicated way. So that's it for algorithms. It's very straightforward, actually, so whenever you're writing an algorithm, I recommend to use iterators, and then it's much more flexible than using fixed containers. So now let's kick it up a notch, and let's talk about containers. That's a little bit more complicated. This one? I'm sorry. Just what? This one? Okay. All right. So containers. So in my mind, the process for writing a container is first you start developing your container, but you don't yet focus too hard on standard library compliancy. Of course, you have to follow a few generic rules, like you should start already by making it a template, but don't worry too much about all the little details. Afterwards, the first important next step is that you add support for iterators, because that will make sure that your container will start working with standard library algorithms. And next, you have to fulfill all the requirements that are required by the standard library for your algorithm to fulfill. And additionally, depending on the type of container, you have sequential containers, you have associative containers, and so on. And all of these different types have an additional set of requirements that you have to fulfill. So let's try to develop a directed graph. What is it? It's a set of vertices that are connected by edges, and all the edges have a direction, so that's where the directed comes from. Vertices are also sometimes called nodes. Here is an example, so all the little circles, those are the nodes. They are connected by arrows, so those are the edges. How will we store that? The vertices we can store as a list, or in my implementation, I will store them as a std vector. And each vertex has a vertex value and something called an adjacency list. And that is a list that contains indices to neighboring vertices, which I will be storing in a std set. So here is an example of three nodes, A, B, C, with a couple of connections between them. And if you look at the data structure, it will be stored as a list of three nodes, A, B, C, and each node has its adjacency list. So node A has two edges, one to node B and one to node C. So, as I said before, let's start writing the algorithm. Let's not focus too much on standard library compliance yet. So let's call it a basic implementation. Just a small disclaimer, this might not be the most performant implementation of a directed graph, but I only have 1 hour, so it's not the most important thing of this session. The important thing is the process of writing a container, not the exact implementation of this specific container. So as I said, we have nodes or vertices, and each node stores a value and an adjacency list. So we will need something called a graph node. And here is a private part of this graph node. So we have at the bottom, we have our M data, that is the value of the node itself. And we have the adjacency list, which is, as I said, a set of indices. And we have two getters to get the list of adjacency indices. It's a hard word. So of course, these getters are rather trivial. You have a non-const and a const one. They just return a reference to our set of indices. That's easy. This is the public part of our graph node. We have two constructors, one that accepts a const t reference and the other one accepting a t ref. So that one, t ref, it's an R value reference. It's not a forwarding reference. Next, we have two getters to get the value of the node, one const and one non-const one. And we have the equality operators and a swap method. The constructors are easy. So the first one is the one accepting const tref. It just makes a copy of the data that you give it to, and we store it in mdata. And the second one uses move semantics to move the data to our graph node. Getters, very easy. They just return a reference, a const reference, or a non-const reference. Equality operators, also straightforward. The equal operator just compares the value of M data and compares the indices, the set of adjacency indices, and operator not equal just forwards to the equality operator. The swap, it just swaps the two data members that I have, and that's it. So that's it for the graph node. So now let's have a look at the directed graph class itself. So here is the private part. It only has one data member, a container, which contains all the nodes. So in this case, as I said before, it's a vector of graph nodes. And then I have a couple of private helper functions. One is a const and a non-const version of find, which accepts the value of a node and which returns me an iterator into my vector of nodes. The other one, remove all links to, it's a helper method. That's one of the more complicated methods that we will write. And this will, based on a node iterator that you give it, it will remove all references to all to this node from all adjacency lists. And then we have another helper method that, given a set of adjacency indices, it converts that into a set of actual values. So let's have a look at the private find helper method. What is it doing? It just uses std find if to find the nodes with the given value. So of course, we are not writing our own loops in this implementation. We have to use standard library algorithms. And the const version is easy. It just forwards. It uses a const cast to just forward to the non-const version of find to avoid code duplication. In this case, there is not much code in the non-const version, but I like this pattern just to avoid duplication. I think it's called the Myers const cast. Next one, the get adjacent node values. So given a set of indices, it converts those indices to actual values. So this one is easy. We just construct an empty set of values. We iterate over the indices and convert these to values, put them in the set, and return that set. That's straightforward. Remove all links. As I said, this is one of the more complicated methods that we will have to implement. So the parameter is an iterator to one of the nodes in our vector. So what we need is an index. So the first thing that we have to do is we calculate the index based on the iterator that we get. And for that, we use another standard library algorithm called std distance. Next, we iterate over all the adjacency lists of all the nodes. So the range-based for loop is iterating over the nodes, and for each node, we get the adjacency indices. And from each list of adjacency indices, we remove the index of the element that we are going to remove. Of course, since my algorithm is based on indices, I have to make sure that the indices stay valid when I remove elements. So that's the second part. I have to modify the remaining indices to account for the one that I just removed. So this one is a bit complicated because I decided to use a set of indices, and you cannot change values in a set. So what I'm doing is just I remove the element from the set and then add it again with the correct value. So this might not be the most performant implementation, but again, that's not really the point of this session. The public interface of our directed graph, of course, we need a way to insert elements and to erase elements, so let's add an insert and erase method. We have two versions of insert, one that accepts a const dereference and the other one accepting a tref. And of course, since we're talking about graphs, we need a way to add and remove edges. So we add an insert edge and we add an erase edge. Next, we need some way to clear everything from our graph. We need a way to have access to a specific node in my graph. Of course, you need equality operators and the usual swap and size method. And then the last one is based on a node value, it will give you a set of adjacent node values. So from outside, you're never working with indices, you always get values. So let's have a look at the insert method. So one of the requirements of my container is that you cannot have duplicates, so we first try to find the value that you want to insert. If it's already there, we return false. Otherwise, we add it to our list of nodes. So this is the move semantic version one. And then the const deref version just forwards to the move semantic version. So that's, again, to avoid code duplication. Next, erase. So given a node value, we have to erase a node from our container. So the first thing we do is we see if it's actually in the container. If not, we return false. If it is, then we call our remove all links to method that we just developed. And then this will remove all the references to the element that I'm deleting from all other adjacency lists. And next, we remove the actual element from our container. And the clear is very easy. MNodes is just a vector, so we can just call clear on it. Insert edge. For insert edge to work, you have to give it a from node and a to node. And I require that both of them exist, so we first check for that. If one of them doesn't exist, we just return false. If they both do exist, then we calculate the index of the to node, and we add that index to the set of adjacency indices from the from node. So this is insert edge. Erase edge is pretty similar. So also you have to specify a from node and a to node. They both need to exist. So if one of them doesn't exist, we return false, and we don't have anything to do. Otherwise, we again calculate the index of the to node, and we remove that from the adjacency indices from the from node. The operator, the index array operators are straightforward. Since we are using a vector for our nodes, we can just forward to our to the array index operator of the vector. And then get adjacent node value. So given a node value, what this function returns is a set of values that are adjacent or connected to this node. So the first thing we do is we try to find the given node. If we don't find it, we just return an empty set. If we do find it, then we ask the adjacency indices from that node, and we convert that using our helper method to adjacent node values. Operator equal, it's a bit, it's non-trivial because it has to work even if you construct two directed graphs and you are setting up your vertices and your connection between the vertices in different order. So even if you do it in different order, two graphs can still be the same. So what we do is we iterate over all the nodes of our left-hand side container. And for each node in that container, we try to find that node in our right-hand side container. If we don't find it, then they are not equal, so we can bail out early. If we do find it, then we have to compare the adjacency nodes, and that's done here. So we get the adjacency node indices for the left-hand side node and for the right-hand side node, and we compare these values. And if all the nodes and all the adjacency lists of all the nodes are the same, then we can return true. Operator not equal, that's just like before. It's just implemented in terms of operator equal equal, so I'm not showing that one. And then the swap method and the size methods, these are all also very easy. They just forward to our vector of nodes, so I'm not showing these either. Then here is a little helper method. So it's an external helper method. It's a function, sorry. It's not a method of our directed graph class. Basically, it gets a graph, it gets a name for the graph, and it outputs the graph in something called a DOT format. This is a standard format for outputting graph structures. So it just writes some header and some footer, and then it iterates over all the nodes in my graph. For each node, it gets the adjacent nodes, and then just writes them to our stream, and that's it. So how can we use this one? Here's an example. I just construct a directed graph of ints. I add a number of elements. I add 5 elements. I construct some edges between them. And then I use my external two dot function to create a dot format, and it looks like this. So it's just a list of all my nodes, and it shows all the connections, so you see node 22 has two connections, one to node 33 and one to node 44. And at the bottom, you can see how I can remove an edge. So I'm removing the edge between 22 and 44. Afterwards, I remove the node 44. I don't know what that 5 is doing there. That shouldn't be there. So this is an example of how to use my directed graph using integers, but it's templated, so I can just use it with strings as well, and it works just as well. So a small side note, when you're writing a lot of templated code, there is a small problem. A method of a class of a class template, it's only compiled when you're actually calling it from somewhere else. So if you're writing a class template with a lot of methods in it, it might be that one of these methods contains compilation errors which go unnoticed if you don't call that method from anywhere else. So what I do is I use explicit template instantiation, and that forces the compiler to actually compile all the methods of your class template, even if a method is not used. And how do you do this? You simply write your explicit template instantiation as follows. So here, I explicit instantiate my graph node for type string, and the same for directed graph. So if you do something like this, you might often just instantiate it for simple types like ints or double, but I actually recommend to instantiate it for more complicated types like strings or other objects, because that might bring up other problems in your code. Okay, so now we have our basic implementation, so let's see what we have to do to make it standard library compliant. So for that, you have to satisfy a number of requirements. So the first thing is you have to support a set of public type aliases. You have a value type, which should be a type alias for the element type that your container has. You need a reference and a const reference type alias, an iterator and const iterator type alias, and then size type and difference type. So the last two are usual. Size type is usually size T. Difference type is usually PTR diff. And if your container is reversible, and our directed graph will support reversible iterators, then you also need to support reverse iterator and const reverse iterators for your container. Additionally to these type aliases, you need a bunch of methods. You have a default constructor, a destructor, you have copy move constructors, copy move assignment operators, and then you have a whole bunch of iterator related methods like begin, cbegin, rbegin if it's reversible, and so on. And then the usual, the equality operators, the swap, size, max size, and empty. So these are the basic container requirements that are specified in the standard library. So let's look at the code. So here are the public type aliases for our directed graph. Value type is very simple, it's just our T. Reference and const reference is also very simple, it's just defined in terms of our value type. And then, as I said before, size type is just type alias for size T, and difference type is just the type alias for PTR diff T. We need a bunch of iterator-related types. So the first one is iterator and const iterator. These are the easiest ones. So these are just type aliases for a class template called const directed graph iterator, which we will implement in one of the next slides. So as you can see, both the iterator and the const iterator are instantiations of the const directed graph iterator. And I did that to follow the std set container, where you can also not change the values. So in my implementation, it's not safe to change the values. So that's why I made the iterator also a const iterator. If you change the implementation to be resistant to changes to values, then you can make this a directed graph iterator. We have the reverse ones, reverse iterator, const reverse iterator. And these are just defined in terms of our other iterator and const iterator, but they are adapted by the std reverse iterator class template. And we also need iterators to be able to iterate over adjacency nodes. So we have the normal ones, the const and a non-const one, and of course the reverse ones, similar to the other. All right, so let's develop our const directed graph iterator. It also needs a bunch of type aliases. It needs a value type, which is the same as a value type of our directed graph, which we take as a template parameter. It also needs a difference type. It needs an iterator category. I mentioned that earlier. So in my case, I will be supporting bidirectional iterations. So I specify the bidirectional iterator tag. I need a pointer and a reference. So they are both const, because it's a const-directed graph iterator. And I need to have an iterator type, which is actually the type of the iterator of the container which contains my nodes. The public interface, it's very easy. We have a constructor that constructs an iterator based on an iterator into our vector of nodes, and given a directed graph, bidirectional iterators should be default constructible, so we explicitly default one here. We have the reference operators, and then increment and decrement operators and equality operators. So these are required by the standard library. The protected members are just restore my iterator to the container of nodes, restore a pointer to my graph, and we have an increment and decrement helper method. So the dereference operators, they are straightforward. One returns a reference, the other one returns a pointer. So that's easy. The increment operators are also easy. They just forward the work to our increment helper. We have both postfixed and prefixed versions of it. And in this case, the increment helper is very trivial. It just increment my iterator member variable. That's it. The decrement versions are exactly the same, so I will not be showing them. And finally, the equality operators are also very simple, so I won't be showing these either. So as you saw with the type aliases I showed before, I'm not using the directed graph iterator, but just so you know how to do it. What I usually do is I create a directed graph iterator which inherits from my const directed graph iterator, and then I change the interface. I'll change the type aliases. It's not a const value type, but it's a non-const value type. I need the same set of constructors, and then these also should return non-const iterators instead of the const one. So one of the vagaries of C++ is that if you're writing these class template hierarchies, then if you want to access something in the base class, then you have to use this arrow. Without this, it will not compile. I have no idea why this is, but that's the case. Now that we have our const directed graph iterator, we have to modify the directed graph a little bit. We just need to add this friend class. And then let's look at the other changes we need to do to our directed graph to make it more standard library compliant. So the first thing we will do is we add an assign method. It's one of the requirements of the standard library. This one just accepts an iterator range, first to last. It clears all the nodes from my current container and then just inserts each element from the given range, just by forwarding it to the one parameter version of insert. We also need an assign method that accepts an std initializer list, and this one just forwards to our first assign method. We also need support for initializer lists in the constructor. So the first one is the constructor accepting a std initializer list, again, just forwarding to my assign method accepting a range of elements. And also you need std initializer list support in the assignment operator. So the implementation is basically the same. It just clears the nodes and then forwards to the assign method accepting an iterator range. So with these, you can construct a graph like this using uniform initialization syntax. Next, we have to add a constructor accepting a range. Also very easy, again. So once you have that assign method that supports the range, a lot of the other methods are rather trivial. our insert method, we have to change it slightly to satisfy the standard library requirements. So before we had two insert methods returning bools and accepting node values. We have to change that to these. They still accept the same type of element, but they should return something like a pair, which a pair of an iterator and a boolean. So the iterator will point to the element that you just inserted or to the element that was already in your set of nodes. And the boolean specify whether we actually inserted it or whether it was a duplicate and we didn't insert it. It's very similar like std set. So here is the implementation of insert. We just try to find our node value. If we don't find it, we return a pair of the iterator. So we try to find the node value. If we do find it, it's a duplicate. So we return a pair of an iterator to the duplicate element and false. If we didn't find it yet, then we insert it and we return an iterator through it and true. The other one, similar as before, it just so the one accepting a const tref just forwards to the move version to avoid code duplication. Arrays, similar, we have to change it a little bit to satisfy standard library philosophy. So before it was, it accepted a value and it returned a boolean. We have to change that and it has to actually accept an iterator and return an iterator. And additionally, we need one version that accepts a range of iterators and that also returns an iterator. The iterator that is returned is the iterator to the element after the one that you deleted or after the last one that you deleted. So here is the one parameter version of arrays. We just try to find our node. If we didn't find it, we return an iterator to the end of our container. And otherwise, we remove all the links to the node that we are going to remove and then actually remove it by calling mNodesArrays and construct an iterator to return. The version that accepts a range, it basically iterates over all the elements in that range, removes all the links to those elements, and then in the last line, we actually erase the whole range and then return an iterator to the element after the last one that we erased. Insert edge, erase edge, and clear, they remain pretty much the same. They remain unchanged compared to the basic implementation, so I'll not be showing these. The index array operator changes slightly because we have these type aliases now, so instead of explicitly saying tref and const tref, we can use our type alias. And similar for the parameter, it used to be size t, now it's size type. And additionally, similar to vector, we add an at method. So the difference is the first one, the operator, the square brackets operator, doesn't throw an exception, it doesn't do any bound checking, while the second one does. So they are very easy, they just forward to our vector. That's trivial. So now we need some iterators. So we have developed our iterator class, so let's start using them. So we need a set of methods, begin end, const version of begin end, and c begin c end. Implementation is easy. The begin method just returns an iterator to the beginning of our container. The end method just returns an end iterator. And these are just implemented in terms of the other one using the const cast pattern. The reverse iterators, because we have a bidirectional, we have a container that supports bidirectional iteration, so we need this set of methods as well. So as you remember, our reverse iterator is defined in terms of std reverse iterator. So basically our rbegin method just returns a reverse iterator to the end. And similar, an rend returns a reverse iterator to the beginning. And similar for crbegin and the const version of these, so I'll not be showing these. We need a similar set of methods to query information, to get iterators for our adjacency nodes. So these were the type aliases that I defined. And we need a set like these. So we have begin, const begin, and cbegin. And these all accept a node value, and they will return you an iterator or a const iterator to the adjacent nodes, to the one that you give it as a parameter. So here is an example of the begin method. It just tries to find the node that you give it. If we don't find it, then we return a default constructed iterator, and that one serves, in this implementation, default constructor, constructed iterator serves as a end iterator. And this is end, that's very similar. And of course, adjacency nodes are also bidirectional, so we have a similar set of reverse iterators. Operator, the equality operators, swap and size, they remain unchanged, so I'm not showing these. Get adjacent node values that we needed in the basic implementation, we don't need anymore, so we can remove that one. And now we need a few additional methods that are required by the standard. First one is max size, second one is empty. They are easy, they just forward to our vector of nodes. And the last one is a swap method. It's a standalone swap function which just forwards to the swap method of our directed class. Here is the modified two-dot standalone function. So this one uses now iterators, as you remember before. It was querying adjacent node values, and then it was not using iterators, so the new one is following more standard library patterns. How to use it? Creating it and inserting elements, inserting edges remain unchanged, so that's that. But now we can use iterators. So here we have a graph called graph, and we are using iterators to iterate over all the elements from the beginning to the end, and we print the elements. So this is exactly the same as you would do with standard library containers like vector, stat, map, set, map, and so on. We can also iterate in reverse because we have bidirectional iterators, so for that one you go from rbegin to rend and outputs the values. With the set of methods that we implemented, so we have a begin, end, and const versions of that, just by implementing these, you can immediately start using the global std cbegin, std cend, std begin, std end, and so on methods or functions. So that's here an example. So we use std cbegin and std cend. We can iterate over all the nodes, all the adjacent nodes to a given node. So in this case, I iterate over all the nodes that are connected to node 22 using iterators. So as I mentioned before, the default constructed adjacent nodes iterator serves as the end iterator. So basically, you get an iterator to the beginning of the adjacent nodes, to the end of the adjacent nodes, and then you can check if the beginning equals the default constructed one, and if that's the case, then we didn't find our node, otherwise we can output all the adjacent node values. And because we have this nice set of iterator methods, begin, end, and so on, that means that range-based for loop will work automatically, so now you can write for autoref node in our graph, and we can print out the node. So we don't have to do anything special for that. You just need to implement a begin and end method. And again, because we have iterators, so once you have iterators, it's very, very powerful. So now you can also use all the standard library algorithms. So here I'm using std find to find certain element, to find element 22. And of course, you could also use our find all algorithm that we developed earlier today. Count if also works. std count if, and we count all the elements that are bigger than 22 in our graph. And here's how you use the iterator-based arrays method. So in this case, we try to find the element 44 and then erase it from our graph. But there are a few things that don't work. So one thing that doesn't work is any modifying algorithm. For example, you cannot use the remove arrays idiom. And that is because our iterator is const. As I explained before, the current implementation doesn't play nice when you change the values. So it's just the same case as with std set. There you can also not modify the values. If you do, if you write something like this, you will get an error like I showed there. You cannot assign to a variable that is const. So this is an error from Visual Studio 2017. The other compilers will be similar. So it's exactly the same as you get when you try to use a modifying algorithm on a set. All right, so that's all for our directed graph following standard library patterns. But there is one small thing missing, and that is allocator support. So I left that for the end. It's a bit more complicated. So a naive implementation of adding allocator support is something like this. So we modify our graph node. We accept a second template parameter, which is our allocator. We modify the constructors to accept an instance of your allocator. Of course, directed graph will also get the second template parameter. And then we store our allocator as a member in our graph node. And another change is that mdata is now a pointer because it will be allocated by the allocator. It's not a value anymore. Which changes do we have to make? So here is the constructor accepting a const TRF. So what this one does is just forwards to the, or just delegates to the constructor accepting a allocator instance, and we just pass it a default allocator a parenthesis. And then the second version of the constructor actually uses the allocator to allocate memory for our mData. That's the first line, and then the second line we are actually copy constructing a T value inside the memory that we just allocated, and it contains a copy of the value that we passed to it. Similar for the move construction, the first one just delegates to the second one, and the second one uses the allocator to allocate memory for mData, and then move constructs a T in place. The destructor first destructs the calls the destructor of my T, and then uses the allocator to deallocate the memory. And this is the copy constructor and the move constructor. So at the bottom, I'm using std exchange to move mData from the source to this. But there is a small problem. So anyone have any idea what is the problem with this code? So it's not exception safe. So if the allocation succeeds, so the calling allocate works and I have allocated my mData memory, but then suppose that the constructor of T throws an exception, then I'm throwing an exception from this graph node constructor, and then my destructor of the graph node will never be called, and I'm leaking my mData. So how can we fix this? One solution is to use a hierarchy where you have a base class that does the actual allocation, and the derived class is doing the construction and destruction of the object. So let's create a graph node allocator. This will be our base class. So you see in this base class, it is storing the allocator and it's storing my mData pointer. And other than that, we don't need a copy constructor. We don't need assignment operators, so I'm explicitly deleting them. The only thing I need is a move constructor and a normal constructor. So here's the implementation. So they are not complicated. So basically they just allocate memory. and the destructor just deallocates the memory, but as you can see, there is no construction of the object and no destruction of the object. That happens in the derived class, so graph node privately inherits from my graph node, from my graph node allocator, sorry. I can remove the allocator member and mData member because I push them to the base class. The constructor just calls the base class constructor, passes our allocator, and then we can remove the call to allocate from the derived class because that's now happening in the base class. The only thing that the derived class has to do is to actually construct the object. And the destructor is similar, so the only thing the derived class has to do is to destroy the object. The deallocation happens in the base class. So now, if you look at this constructor, if the construction of T fails, then everything will be cleaned up nicely because C++ guarantees that it will call the destructor for every object that was fully or successfully constructed. So in this case, my base class, if the allocation succeeds, my base class object will be successfully constructed. So even if this throws, C++ will call the destructor of my base class, which will do the proper deallocation. What do we have to change in our directed graph? Not much. So we just add the template parameter. We need a second or an additional type alias. We add a couple of constructors that accept an allocator instance. According to the standard library, it's required to have a getAllocator method that simply returns you the allocator. Here we forward the allocator to our container of nodes. We store it, and here as well, we pass the allocator to our std set. There I'm using a transparent operator, std::less, empty brackets. The strange construct for the default constructor, no accept, no accept A, just marks that default constructor as no accept, but only if the default constructor of my allocator is no accept. So that's it. So now we have a directed graph that follows standard library patterns and the philosophy of the standard library, and which has support for allocators. There are a couple of improvements that we can make, of course. So as I mentioned a couple of times, my iterator is const, so the current algorithm does not play well if you change the elements. So yeah, if you modify the implementation and you modify it so it's resilient to changes to the elements, then you can mark that iterator as non-const. Also, the current implementation is a directed graph. It's not a directed acyclic graph, so it's not checking for any cycles. And that's it. That's how you write standard library compliant algorithms and data structures. Any questions? Yes. Could you use the could you use the microphone?
In your graph, the node values are all unique and they're immutable. Mm-hmm. Wouldn't using a set as an underlying container be more, you know, natural choice instead of vector?
Yes, you could use set as an underlying data structure, but then you cannot use an index-based algorithm that I'm using. So as you know, the adjacency nodes, the list of adjacency nodes are indices to other nodes. So if you're using a set, I cannot use indices anymore, then you would have to modify that algorithm as well. But it's definitely possible, yes. That would make, for example, the equality operator, the implementation would be easier, and that's true. Yeah.
Sorry, I don't have a slide number for you, but early in the brief, you used a lot of range loops, range for loops that said either auto, ampersand, ampersand, so you're taking R values. Could you have used just a const ref there too?
Yes.
Or is that just a performance improvement?
Definitely. It's just I usually use auto ref Most of the times it's not important. Most of the times you can just use a const href. Yes.
Okay. No problem. I was thinking, or it's not disemboweling the piece you're taking out of your list of nodes and then giving it off to something else.
No. You can just use const href as well. Yes.
Okay. If you wanted to create a specific graph type using the directed graph, what would be the best relationship that represents this? Would it be inheritance or composition?
Sorry, I'm not clear. So you want to?
So if I wanted to create an undirected graph by using the directed graph.
Yeah.
Now, what would be the best way to wrap this? Would it be inheritance?
That's up to you. You can use inheritance, or you can use composition. It's up to you. Yes. That's.
So what would be easier to make it STL compliant?
Probably I would use composition, yes. It's the same with a vector. If you want to modify slightly the behavior of a vector, you will usually not inherit from the vector, right? So it's the same here.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep. All right, no more questions? Thank you.